Look at your watch or your phone. You have a meeting. You have a deadline. You have a schedule to keep. We run around trying to fight the clock. We structure our entire reality around the concept of time. But if I ask you to explain what time is, you can't. You can only say what's happening in time. It's the single most universal concept that we use. But at the same time, it's the deepest, most counterintuitive mystery we have ever faced. It's mind-boggling because we'll never find time. We'll never experience the past. The future never arrives. All there is now. So, is time real? Or is it an illusion? The fascinating thing is that when we stop treating physics and spirituality as two separate ideas and start weaving together the deepest insights from people like Einstein and David Bohm and the ancient mystics, we might finally work out what's going on. For centuries, we assumed that physical time was absolute, a great big clock ticking behind the universe. Then Einstein came along and smashed that clock up. Relativity showed us that physical time is also relative. It literally varies depending on the observer's speed and on the intensity of the local gravitational field. You take two clocks and you put one on the floor and one up on a shelf. The one on the floor is going to run slower than the one on the shelf because gravity is more intense closer to the Earth. Obviously, this wouldn't be noticeable with two normal clocks, but in a laboratory with an atomic clock, this has been shown to be true. I've been reading Wholeness and the Implicate Order by David Bohm, and he says that at the deepest level, the difference between time and space actually breaks down. He argues that what we see as separate moments in time aren't actually like beads on a string, one causing the other. Instead, they are projections from a deeper, higher dimensional reality. Think of it like a movie. The scenes look separate, but they're actually all projecting from the same film reel. Long before modern physics, the great sages were saying the same thing. In Advaita Vedanta, the self, the true self, the Atman, is said to be timeless. It cannot be said to arise or end in time. Time is only a category of the empirical or phenomenal world. Ramana Maharshi said it directly. The idea of time is only in your mind. It is not in the self. There is no time for the self. Time arises as an idea after the ego arises. By the way, if you want to read any of the books that I mention in the video, there are affiliate links in the description, so it won't cost you any more and it'll help support the channel. The ancient texts of the Bible actually use two different words for time, and the distinction is crucial. Chronos, which is the time of the clock and the calendar, it is sequential and measurable time. This one is used, for example, when Jesus says, "It is not for you to know the times or the dates the Father has fixed." So this is showing length or duration, which can be measured. Then the second word is Kairos, which means something completely different. It means the right moment, the eternal moment when something significant is revealed. For example, when Jesus says, "The kingdom of God is at hand," he's not talking about Chronos, he's talking about Kairos, a present awakening which can be experienced right now, not something that can be measured in the future. It is the moment in which eternity touches the present. Physics still grapples with one profound mystery. Why does time flow in a forward direction? Why is the past different from the future? Well, scientists have found that time is intimately linked with entropy. Sean Carroll, for example, explains entropy as something which measures the disorderliness of an object. Entropy has a stubborn tendency to increase or at least stay constant as the time passes. This is why, as he points out, you can always scramble an egg, but you can never unscramble it. But the mystery deepens. Carlo Rovelli, one of the founders of loop quantum gravity, points out that at the most fundamental level, at the Planck scale, time simply ceases to exist in the equations. The reality he describes has changed, but there is no single universal timeline. Instead, he says that every process dances independently with its neighbours, following its own rhythm. The passing of time is intrinsic to the world. It is born of the world itself, out of the relations between quantum events, which are the world and which themselves generate their own time. Robert Lanza's Biocentrism suggests that our sense of time is a fabrication, a projection from within us. What we perceive as the flow of time is simply our mind stitching together a series of still frames. Think of Zeno's famous arrow paradox. Zeno said that for an arrow to be moving forward, it must first be at a specific point. If it's at a specific point, then it must be at rest. If it's always at rest, then how can it ever be moving forward? Motion is not really what's occurring. It's a series of still events that the mind is stitching together into a flow. Time is simply not a feature of the external spatial world. So, does time exist? Yes, in the realm of Chronos. It helps us to function, and it organizes our biological life, and it helps us to survive. But in the deepest sense, time is not a river or a container. It is a pattern arising within timeless awareness. From the non-dual perspective, there is only this awareness, this knowing. The past is a memory appearing now, and the future is an expectation appearing now. And the present moment is not a moment in time, it is timeless. If you want to explore more connections between science and spirituality, then watch this video next.